Hi students, today we are going to study about inequalities. Here we are going to see what are the different principles of solving an inequality. Also we are going to see about what is absolute value and problems based on that. Further we are going to see quadratic inequalities and the polynomial inequalities. Also we are going to study about how to solve inequalities on more than one variable and a system of inequalities. At the last, we are going to study about the inequality that relates the arithmetic mean and the geometric mean of positive numbers. So let's begin. Let us say that these are the two kids who are playing with balls. Now, my question to you is, who has got more number of balls? Clearly, this boy has got more balls. He has more balls to play with. So by counting the number of balls, we can tell that this boy has got more number of balls as compared to this girl. Let us say that we have got two blocks A and B and we have placed them in this balance. Now the balance moves this way. If I ask you which block is lighter in this case, then of course your answer should be B, because the weight of A is more than the weight of B. And so B is lighter than A. Let us take one more example. Let us say that we have got two varieties of rice. One is sold at 20 rupees per kg and the other one is sold at 15 rupees per kg. Now, which of these two varieties is costlier? Of course, this rice is costlier. Now, what is so common in all these examples? Yeah, definitely we have compared the measure of two quantities and we have seen which quantity is greater or which quantity is lesser. Whenever we make a comparison, we make the comparison of the measure of two quantities, which is quite evident from the examples we have taken. Now, to denote which quantity is more than the other quantity, we use the concept of inequalities. Inequalities helps us to get an idea of which quantity is greater or which quantity is lesser. So, let's see what are inequalities. An inequality states that one real quantity or expression is greater than or less than another real quantity or expression. So, what is an inequality? It helps us to state that one real quantity or expression is greater than or less than other real quantity. So, actually we make a comparison between the measure of two quantities. Either one quantity could be less than the other one or it could be greater than the other one. It could also be equal to the other one. So there are three cases. Either it could be less than or it could be greater than or it could even be equal to the other quantity. Now, how do we denote that? If we have a quantity A which is greater than the quantity B, then it is denoted by A greater than B. This sign or this symbol denotes that A is greater than B. This symbol or this sign denotes greater than. If we use this symbol, then it denotes that the quantity A is greater than the quantity B. Similarly, if we have A less than B, let us say that there are two quantities A and B and the measure of A is less than the measure of B, then it is denoted by A less than B. So it's important that this sign denotes greater than and this sign denotes less than. Now let's look at the meaning of different symbols. First is A greater than B. Now what does this denote? It simply means that A is greater than B. Quantity A is greater than B. Now if A is greater than B, then A minus B would be a positive number. So because A is greater than B, the measure of A is greater than B. Therefore the number A minus B would always be positive. Now if you come across this statement, this simply denotes that A is less than B or A minus B is a negative number. Because the measure of A is less than B, therefore the number A minus B would be a negative number. So this denotes A less than B and this denotes A greater than B. The third is A is greater or equal to B. So this symbol actually denotes A is greater than or equal to B. It could never be less than B. It could either be equal to B or it could be greater than B, but it could never be less than B. This denotes that A is less than or equal to B. So this symbol with an equality sign denotes that A is less than or equal to B. It can never be greater than B. If you come across this statement, which is A is greater than 0 and which is less than 1, then what does this mean? It simply means that A is greater than 0 but less than 1. So A lies between 0 and 1, and A cannot be equal to neither of the quantities 0 and 1. So simply, such type of statement means that A is greater than 0 but less than 1. Instead of 0 and 1, we can have different numbers. Let's say they are B and C. So if we replace 0 by B and 1 by C, then it would mean that A is greater than B but less than C. So A lies between B and C, and both these points B and C are not included. Now if you come across this statement like x belongs to 0, 1, now it simply means that value of x lies between 0 and 1, both not included. So this statement actually means that the value of x lies between 0 and 1. It could be 0.5, it could be 0.3, and so on. But it would not be equal to 0 and it would not be equal to 1. So this bracket sign denotes that the value of x lies between 0 and 1, both not included. If you come across this type of statement that x belongs to -1, 3, here the bracket sign has changed, then it simply means that value of x lies between -1 and 3, where x can be equal to -1 but not equal to 3. This is a closed and this is an open bracket, in which it means that x belongs to -1 to 3 and -1 is included. That is, x can be equal to -1, but as this is open bracket, therefore it means that x would not be equal to 3. So this type of statement means that, first of all, x lies between -1 and 3 and x can be equal to -1, but it should not be equal to 3. If you have such type of statement, then what does it mean? It means that value of x lies between -1 and 4, where x can be equal to -1 and 4. Here you see that both these brackets are closed brackets. Therefore, x can lie between -1 and 4. Also, it can have the values -1 and 4. Both are included. In this, both these values are not included. In such type of statement, only this value is included. That is, x can be equal to -1, but it cannot be equal to 3. And in this type of statement, when we have a closed bracket, then it means that x can have the value equal to -1, and x can also have the value equal to 4. So this was some of the important statements and their meanings. Now, let's move on to the principles of inequalities. The first principle is that the inequality remains unchanged when a same number is added or subtracted from both the sides of inequality. The first principle says that if we add or subtract a same quantity from both the sides of the inequality, then the inequality remains the same. So let's take an example. Let us say that we have an inequality 4 > 3. Of course, we know that 4 > 3. So this is one inequality. If we add 2 to both sides of this inequality, then LHS of the inequality becomes 4 + 2 and RHS becomes 3 + 2. Now 4 + 2 = 6 and 3 + 2 = 5. So we get the inequality as 6 > 5, which is actually true. So what do we see? That if we add same number to both sides of the inequality, the inequality remains the same. Here it is greater than. So it remains greater than. The LHS remains greater than RHS. Similarly, let's try to subtract 2 from both the sides of this inequality. What do we get? We get LHS as 4 - 2 and the RHS as 3 - 2. 4 - 2 = 2 and the RHS would be 1. And we also know that 2 is greater than 1. So what do we see? We see that this inequality is also true. So if we subtract 2 from both the sides of this inequality, the inequality remains the same. So what we can say, the inequality remains unchanged when the same number is added or subtracted from both the sides of the inequality. The next principle is, each side of an inequality can be multiplied or divided by the same positive quantity. So if we have an inequality, then we can multiply or divide both the sides of the inequality by a same positive quantity. Here, important thing is, we are multiplying or dividing by a positive quantity. It should not be negative one. Let's take the same inequality, 4 > 3. Now multiplying both sides by 2. Let us multiply both the sides by 2. What do we get? 4 × 2 > 3 × 2. This becomes 8 > 6, and which is actually true. We know that 8 > 6. So what do we see? If we multiply both the sides by a same positive quantity, then inequality remains the same. Now let's look at the second part of this. Let's try to divide both the sides by 2. Now if we divide this by 2 and the RHS also by 2, what do we get? 2 greater than 1.5, which is also true. So what do we see? We see that if both the sides of the inequality are multiplied or divided by a same positive quantity, then the inequality remains the same. It does not change. Let's move on to the next principle, and it says that if each side of an inequality is multiplied or divided by the same negative quantity, the sign of inequality must be reversed so that the new inequality is equivalent to the first one. So if we multiply or divide the sides of the inequality by a same negative number, now we are taking the case of a negative number, then the inequality must be reversed. So a greater than inequality becomes less than inequality to have the new inequality equivalent to the first one. Let us say that we have again the same inequality, 4 greater than 3. Now multiplying both sides by minus 2, let us multiply both the sides by minus 2. So according to this principle, we are going to reverse the sign of this inequality. This greater than becomes less than. So 4 into minus 2 is less than 3 into minus 2. This becomes minus 8 less than minus 6, which is true. We always know that minus 8 is less than minus 6. So what do we see? We see that if we are multiplying both the sides by a same negative quantity, then we have to reverse the sign of inequality. Now what we do is, we divide both the sides by minus 2. So 4 divided by minus 2 should be less than 3 divided by minus 2. Again, we are going to reverse the sign of inequality. Greater than has to be changed to less than. This becomes minus 2 less than minus 1.5, and which is true. So what do we see? If we multiply or divide both the sides of the inequality by a same negative quantity, then we got to change the sign of the inequality. That is, if we have a greater than sign, then it has to become less than sign, or if it is a less than sign, then it has to become a greater than sign. The next is, if A is greater than B and A, B and N are positive numbers, then A to the power of N is greater than B to the power of N, but A to the power of minus N is less than B to the power of minus N. So let us say that we have an inequality A greater than B, and let us say that we have got three positive numbers A, B and N. Then in such a case, A to the power of N would always be greater than B to the power of N, but A to the power of minus N be less than B to the power of minus N. Let's again take an example. Let's consider the same inequality, 4 greater than 3. Now let us say that N is equal to 2. So let us first assume that N is a positive quantity. 4 square would be greater than 3 square this way. And we also know that 4 square would be 16 and 3 square would be 9. And we also know that 16 is greater than 9. So this inequality is true. And so from this we have proved this part. Let's see the second part. Let's try to prove the second part. Let us say that N is equal to minus 2. So 4 to the power of minus 2 would be less than 3 to the power of minus 2. According to this, now this would be 1 by 16 less than 1 by 9, which is actually true. So what do we see? We see that if A is greater than B, then A to the power of N should be greater than B to the power of N, but A to the power of minus N should be less than B to the power of minus N. In this case, A, B and N are all positive numbers. So these were some of the basic principles of inequalities which we are going to use to solve problems on inequalities. Now we shall see a very important concept, which is absolute value. Now what exactly is absolute value? Absolute value helps us to know the measure of any quantity. It does not take into consideration its sign, but the exact measure or the magnitude of any quantity is the absolute value. This absolute value is denoted by this symbol, two vertical bars, and this is pronounced as modulus of x. So modulus of x denotes the absolute value of this quantity x. X is any quantity, and this denotes the absolute value of x. Now what exactly is the absolute value in mathematical terms? Now there are two cases. Either this quantity x could be greater or equal to 0, that is a positive quantity, and the second case is x is less than 0. So there are only two cases. Either x could be greater or equal to 0, or it would be less than 0. If x is greater than equal to 0, then mod x would be equal to x. So if this is a positive quantity, then we directly write mod x as equal to x. But if this is a negative quantity, then mod x would be equal to minus x, and that is the definition of absolute value of x. Absolute value of x is equal to x when x is greater or equal to 0, and if this quantity is less than 0, then the modulus of x would be equal to minus 6. Your x is the quantity which is inside the modulus sign. For example, let us say that x is equal to 2. Then modulus of 2 would be equal to 2 because x is greater or equal to 0. And so that would be equal to x, and which is equal to 2. So modulus of 2 would be equal to 2. But if x is equal to minus 2, let us say, so it falls in this category, x is less than 0. So modulus of minus 2 would be equal to minus of minus 2, and that would be equal to 2. So we see that in both the cases, we get the modulus as equal to 2, which is positive. So modulus of x would always give a positive value. And that is why we said that absolute value gives us the magnitude of any quantity. In the final result, sign does not play an important role. Even if x is equal to minus 2, then modulus of minus 2 would be equal to 2. Here we have written minus x because x is less than 0. So minus of minus 2 is equal to 2. So that is the definition of absolute value of x. Now let's see the graph of modulus x. The modulus x is defined as equal to x if x is greater or equal to 0, and that is equal to minus x if x is less than 0. So we see that this red portion denotes the graph of y equal to modulus x. So when x is positive or x is greater than 0, we see that y would be equal to x from the definition of modulus x. The part of the line y equal to x for x greater than 0 represents this part, the right hand side part of this graph. And we also see that y would be equal to minus x when x is less than 0, when x is negative, it would be equal to minus x. So this portion represents the graph of modulus x when x is less than 0, and this portion represents the graph of y equal to modulus x when x is greater or equal to 0. So this is a graph of absolute value. Also, you can note here that, as I already said, that modulus of x would be always positive. So we see that the entire portion of this graph lies above the x-axis, that is, it is positive. None of the part of this graph comes in these two quadrants. So y would never be a negative quantity. So y, which is equal to modulus of x, would never be a negative quantity. So this is the graph of y equal to modulus of x. It can be broken into two parts. The first part, which is y equal to x for x greater or equal to 0, and y equal to minus x for the part for which x is less than 0. Now, what is modulus of x minus a? Earlier we have seen what is modulus of x. Now let's see what is modulus of x minus a. Now this would be x minus a if x is greater or equal to a. And this would be minus of x minus a if x is less than a. Now why it is so? If x is greater or equal to a, then this quantity which is inside the modulus sign would be positive. And we know that if this quantity would be positive, then that would be directly equal to this quantity, which is x minus a. And if x is less than a, then this quantity inside the modulus sign would be a negative quantity. And we have seen that y is equal to minus x when x is less than 0. So this quantity being negative would be equal to minus of x minus a for this entire quantity to be positive. For x greater or equal to a, we have modulus of x minus a equal to x minus a. And for x less than a, we have modulus of x minus a equal to minus of x minus a. Simply, we have to see the values of x for which this very quantity inside the modulus sign is positive and the values for which this quantity is negative. Now, what about this inequality, modulus of x minus a greater than b? So, it might be possible that you come across such type of inequality that modulus of x minus a is greater than b. Now, if x is greater or equal to a, then this quantity would be positive, and so the inequality would become x minus a greater than b, or we can say x greater than a plus b. So when x is greater or equal to a, this inequality becomes x greater than a plus b. And if x is less than a, then this quantity would be negative, and so modulus of x minus a would be equal to minus of x minus a. And so this would be minus of x minus a greater than b. This further becomes x less than a minus b. So what do we get? For x greater or equal to a, we have x greater than a plus b, and for x less than a, we have x less than a minus b. So when we combine both these, what do we get? either xs less than a minus p or xs greater than a plus p. So what we have done here is we have considered the quantity under the modulus sign, and then further we have solved this inequality. So for such type of inequality, x is less than a minus b or x is greater than a plus b. Now let's solve a few examples to understand the concept of inequalities. So the first is modulus of x minus 5 greater than 7, and the second part is modulus of x minus 2 less than equal to 6. Now we shall solve these two inequalities. The first is modulus of x minus 5 greater than 7. Now from the definition of modulus, either x minus 5 is greater than 7, this quantity being positive, or x minus 5 is less than minus 7, this quantity being negative. So we have got these two inequalities. From this inequality, x minus 5 greater than 7, what do we get? We get x greater than 12. And from this inequality, what do we get? X less than minus 2. And so if we combine both these, what do we get? We get x greater than 12 or x less than minus 2. So for the values of x which are less than minus 2, this inequality holds. And for the values of x greater than 12, again this inequality holds. So the solution set for this is x is greater than 12 or x is less than minus 2. Always remember, for inequalities we get a range of values of x, not a particular value as in the case of equality. So this range of solution would be x greater than 12 or x less than minus 2. Let's solve the second part, which is modulus of x minus 2 is less than equal to 6. Now again we are going to use the same logic and see whether this quantity x minus 2 is positive or negative. So this would be x minus 2 less than equal to 6 when x minus 2 is greater than equal to 0. Or this would be x minus 2 greater or equal to minus 6 when this quantity is negative. Again, from this inequality, what do we get? We get x greater or equal to minus 4. And from this one, what do we get? We get x is less than equal to 8. Again, on combining both these inequalities, what we get? X greater or equal to minus 4 or x is less than equal to 8. So the solution set would be either x is less than equal to 8 or x is greater or equal to minus 4. So just using the concept of modulus or the absolute value, we have solved these two problems. Let's solve one more example. Solve modulus of x plus 2 plus modulus of x plus 3 plus modulus of x plus 5 less than 800. So in this problem, we have to solve that modulus of x plus 2 plus modulus of x plus 3 plus modulus of x plus 5 less than 800. So the inequality given to us is modulus of x plus 2 plus modulus of x plus 3 plus modulus of x plus 5 less than 800. How to solve such type of problems? The funda is to solve such questions, only solve for the extreme conditions for equality from the options. So in this case, modulus of x plus 2 and modulus of x plus 5 are the extremes. So x plus 2 and x plus 5 are the extremes in this case, and we are going to solve for these extreme conditions. Now here the quantity x plus 2 would be equal to 0 when x is equal to minus 2, and this quantity x plus 5 would be equal to 0 when x is equal to minus 5. So the extreme conditions here, or the extreme points here, are x equal to minus 2 and x equal to minus 5. Now we are going to represent these two points on the number line. Let us say that this is the number line and we have represented these two points, minus 2 and minus 5, over here. Now this represents all the values of x which are less than minus 5. Now when x is less than minus 5, then what do we see? We see that this would be a negative quantity, this would be a negative quantity, and this would also be a negative quantity. That is, all the three quantities x plus 2, x plus 3 and x plus 5 would be negative as x is less than minus 5. So this equation in this case would become minus of x plus 2 plus minus of x plus 3 minus x plus 5 less than 800. Why? Because we see that if the quantity under the modulus sign is negative, then that would be equal to minus of the quantity. So here this would become minus of x plus 2 minus x plus 3 minus x plus 5 less than 800. This further becomes 3x greater than minus 810, or x greater than minus 270. So when x is less than minus 5, we get x greater than minus 270. This would give the range of x as x greater than minus 270 and less than minus 5. So this inequality is satisfied when x is greater than minus 270 and less than minus 5. Minus 5 because we have taken the case that x is less than minus 5. Now, the second extreme would be x equal to minus 2. So what do? We take the values of x which are greater than minus 2. Now when x is greater than minus 2, you see that all the three quantities become positive. X plus 2 would be positive, x plus 3 would be positive, and x plus 5 would also be positive. So all the quantities under the modulus sign becomes positive, and so this inequality becomes x plus 2 plus x plus 3 plus x plus 5 less than 800. This further becomes 3x plus 10 less than 800, or x less than 790 by 3. So what do we get? We get x less than 790 by 3, and also x should be greater than minus 2. Now we shall see one more top coaching panda, and this is when quantities in the mod are added such that the coefficient of x is unity in each case, then the minimum value of the equation exists at one of the values found by equalities in mod equal to 0. So this panda says that if we have quantities in the modulus sign and they are added such that each and every quantity in the modulus has a coefficient of x equal to 1, a unity coefficient, the minimum value of the equation exists at one of the values found by equalities in modulus equal to 0. So in simple words, if each of the quantities under the modulus sign has the coefficient of x as unity or equal to 1, then equate all these terms to 0 and the minimum value of the entire expression would be at one of the such point. Right now it might be very confusing. So let's solve an example to understand this. The question says that y is equal to modulus of x minus 2 plus modulus of 2.5 minus 6 plus modulus of 3.6 minus 6. Then y is minimum at, first option is x is equal to 2.3, second is x equal to 2.5, third is x equal to 2.7, and the fourth option is none of these. So we have been given an expression y equal to modulus of x minus 2 plus modulus of 2.5 minus x plus modulus of 3.6 minus x. We have to find out at what value of x the minimum value of y occurs, and we have been given the four options. So again, what we are going to do is we are going to use the same top coaching funda. Putting quantities under the mod equal to 0, what do we get? If we put all these quantities under the modulus sign and equate these terms to 0, what do we get? X as equal to 2, x as equal to 2.5, and x as equal to 3.6. You note that the coefficient of each and every term here is unity. It is a linear expression. Now, from the top coaching panda, the minimum value of y would occur at any of these three points. So what we are going to do is, we are going to substitute these values of x as equal to 2, 2.5 and 3.6 in this expression to find out the value of y. And the value of x for which we get the value of y as minimum would be the point at which minimum value of y occurs. So when x is equal to 2, then y would be equal to 2.1. Simply substitute x equal to 2 in this expression, we get the value of y as equal to 2.1. When x is equal to 2.5, then the value of y would be equal to 1.6. And when x is equal to 3.6, what do we get? We get the value of y as equal to 2.7. So what do we see? We see that the value of y is minimum at x equal to 2.5. So the answer here in this case would be, at x equal to 2.5, we get the minimum value of y. This is how we solve such type of problems using a top coaching funda. See one more very important funda, and that is, when two absolute quantities are added, the value of their total remains the same on any value of the variable lying between the values found by equating the quantities under modulus equal to 0, and that is the minimum value of the sum. So when two absolute quantities are added, that is, there are two expressions which are under the modulus sign, and if they are added, then the total remains the same on any value of the variable lying between the values found by equating the quantities under the modulus sign equal to 0. That would be the minimum value of the sum. Again, let's try to see an example to understand this. Find the values of x for which y equal to modulus of x plus 7 plus modulus of 9 minus 6 is minimum. So in this case, we have got two terms, modulus of x plus 7 and modulus of 9 minus 6. We have to find out the value of x for which this sum is minimum. Now, equating quantities in between modulus sine equal to 0, we get x equal to minus 7 and x equal to 9. So in this case, again, we are going to equate this term to 0, we get the value of x as equal to minus 7. So at x equal to minus 7, this quantity would be equal to 0. And similarly, when x is equal to 9, this quantity would be equal to 0. Now we are going to use the same result. It says that the value of y would be minimum when the value of x lies between these two values. So let us draw the number line and plot these two points, minus 7 and 9. So when x is equal to minus 7, this quantity would be equal to 0. And when x is equal to 9, this quantity would be equal to 0. So all the values of x between minus 7 and 9, we get the value of y as minimum. So for all these values of x between minus 7 and 9, we get the minimum value of y. And that would also be a constant value. For example, 0 comes between minus 7 and 9. X equal to 0 is a point between minus 7 and 9. So when we substitute x equal to 0, what do we get? 7 plus 9, which is equal to 16. If we put x equal to 1, this becomes 8 and this becomes 8. 8 plus 8 is equal to 16. If we put x equal to 2, what do we get? This has 9 and this has equal to 7. So 9 plus 7 would be equal to 16. So what do we see? We see that for all the values of x between minus 7 and 9, in this particular case, give the value of y as equal to 16, which is constant throughout. This is the minimum value of y. So these were some of the very important results regarding the absolute value. Now we are going to see how to solve quadratic inequations.